But yeah, so I'm Stephen Howell. We're going to be talking about Bokeh. This is my GitHub or Twitter handle, the GitHub repo. Everybody should be set up. Just to reiterate, we're going to be using Jupyter Notebooks. So there's a few steps involved in this. One was to get the Conda repository. The repository that I set up for the course. Two is to get Conda and get your Conda environment, which I think everybody got that far. And then to then activate that Conda environment, the virtual environment, and then from that virtual environment, start a Jupyter Notebook server. And then you should have this, we open your Jupyter Notebook server. If you just run Jupyter Notebook from inside this directory, it'll look like that. The README was out of date. I changed notebooks to material because it was more than just notebooks. And so this is your like a file browser, right? So these are the files. The introduction one is what we're looking at here. This has a setup. So once you get the environment set up and the notebook running, you can click on the cell. And this is the Jupyter Notebook is kind of a mix between a Python IDE and an interactive Python shell. So you can put code in here. It doesn't actually execute until you hit Shift Enter. And then it'll run everything in that cell, and then put the output immediately below it. And just like your Python shell, all the commands you've run previously will be stored in memory, and you can access them and build on them. But if you look at the notebook, the order of the cells on the page won't change what was executed previously, right? So just because the cell's higher, if you don't ever run it, it doesn't get run. Not in memory, so just be cognizant of that. So when you run this first cell, you should see it does an import, it gets the versions, it prints them out. You should see this, that you have IPython, pandas, and Bokeh. Okay. Yeah, so you downloaded the GitHub repo from a command shell, like this here. You're gonna execute Jupyter Notebook. Yeah, but actually, sorry. First, you have to activate the virtual environment, which is pretty JavaScript libraries from the web. It looks like everybody had success with that, so that's excellent. And then this next cell is kind of doing a similar thing, calling in the HoloViews library, data shader, and then telling him we're going to use Bokeh to output HoloViews, and that should have worked all right. So, great. I only seen green stickies. Go ahead and take your green stickies off, and we'll keep going. So, the schedule of this is a rough outline. 10 minutes to do the setup and intro. We were fortunate everybody came super early, so I think we're all set up pretty much. I'll finish going through this. Then we're going to go through the basic plotting interface for Bokeh plotting API. We're going to look at a pseudo streaming data example. And that's, kind of pretty cool. And then data shader, plotting lots of data, and then the Bokeh server. And then I left 10 minutes really again for cushion. While we're going through, particularly when we get to the exercises, please ask questions. Let me know if there's any questions you have. And again, if I'm going too fast, please stick your note up. Yeah. about me, I like to solve data-driven problems. I've been doing that for a long time. In my current position, I'm a researcher at NIST in Gaithersburg, Maryland. I do scientific software applications, analyze data. I'm looking at a certain protein in highly concentrated solutions, trying to understand the structure of these proteins. And I'm in that position for another 2 weeks. In 2 weeks, I'll be starting at Booz Allen Hamilton. Looking forward to that. PhD from George Washington University and proud father of three. This is my youngest. She was born a week and 2 days ago, so she was with me while I was cleaning all this up. So, yeah. So about Bokeh, interactive data visualization, and that's the key. I imagine a lot of you are familiar with maybe Matplotlib or Plotly or other things. How many of you, just to kind of get a feel, how many have used Bokeh before? Raise your hands. Okay, so a few. How many of you have heard of Bokeh? Yeah. And how many of you have maybe seen a Bokeh dashboard that somebody else made and you kind of played with it? Okay, great. So by the end, you'll all raise your hand for all. So the way Bokeh works is it's a layered tool where you have your data and then we want to make D3 like visualizations using the HTML canvas, but we don't want to leave Python, right? So there's the Bokeh Python layer and then there's the JavaScript layer below that. So Bokeh. From Python, you send commands to Bokeh, which then sends commands to JavaScript and passes it there, and then that renders on your browser window or Jupyter notebook or whatever it may be. And because of that layered approach, you can actually pull out the Python bit and you can put in R for those who use R or Scala, and if you have some other programming language that you'd like to work with Bokeh, they're happy for contributions. So, but yeah, and it can handle large data sets, dynamic data sets, streaming, and it does some pretty cool things. So there's three different levels, or three different API. The lowest level is the Bokeh models level. We're not going to cover that today, but I put links here to the docs and the tutorial notebooks so that if you want to go into that, or if you have that need, you can find it. So on top of the Bokeh models, you have Bokeh plotting, and it'll create Bokeh models objects. And that's what we're gonna start out by looking at. And then the third level, it was Bokeh charts up until a few months ago. Now they've replaced that with HoloViews, and there's a lot of active development that has just taken place, and they've just put out a lot of great documentation for that. So be sure to check out all these other resources here. And some of what you're going to see today, I've adapted or pulled in from a lot of these other resources. There's a lot more material than what we could cover in the 2 hours here, so I've tried to pick a few things that I hope are interesting and give you a feel, a taste, and get you started. So that, let's come up and click on the basic plotting interface, and it'll open this next notebook. Everybody, clear? So if you have been looking at this kind of outline, you click Bokeh, our basic plotting interface, it'll open the next notebook for us. Which should look like this. Yeah. Right. So, the first import, this base import includes Bokeh.plotting. Then we're going to load the JavaScript layer. This is loading from the web. If you're not connected to the internet, you can get the JavaScript locally. Just, instead of, you also have to import located resources. And then when you do locate plotting on the notebook, pass it the resources inline, and that will instead do it locally. I had to look that up a couple times because of the resolution I did to the web. Okay, so, and then there's a lot of palettes that Bokeh has available to you, and I really like this method of importing them so that I'm going to use this palette, create all my visualizations, and this other guy really doesn't like this palette. All right, let's go back and just switch out the import, and then all my code will stay running. Sorry, technically. Yeah, so now I have this other palette, and all of the palette is just a list of hex strings for the colors. You can also just use basic colors like blue, red, yellow, whatever. Try it. And then we're going to use NumPy to create our data, and then with that, and then set our stats. So, say that again?
It's not how I can put that in, but some of
the rules. Stats. Yeah, remove the underscore. Try it. One great thing you can do is this supports tab completion. So here I have color blue. I set it in tab, and it'll tell me what's available. And then I can go down and select something. See if that looks up. Does the category 10 underscore 10 work?
Oh, that's what I'm doing here.
Let me come back. What about 2 and a half percent? I'll come back. Let's start out with a plot, and just so when you're generating a Bokeh plot, you can pass any of the input values except either a single value or a series of values, whether that's a list, a NumPy array, pandas data frame, column, I think series set. You pass it in, and it does a really good job of matching up. So if you only pass in one value for the X and 30 values for the Y, it's going to match that up, expand it out. And so then for this tutorial, we're going to be looking at a Gaussian function a lot, or also known as a normal distribution. There's a wiki link if you want to look at that later. But this is the gist of it. There's this sigma factor that controls how wide our distribution is going to be. And this mu factor, which controls where the average is at. And then f of x, that's going to be your y-axis, and x is going to be your x-axis. So for what it's worth, that's what the data that we're going to keep creating and running. So let's do this. I'm going to make 3 Gaussian distributions. And here I create a figure object. Then with that object, I'm calling the diamond attribute, passing it an x NumPy array, y1 is also a NumPy array, and then calling Bokeh plotting show, and there with those 3 lines of code, you get this pretty good plot, right? And you have interactions. You can zoom. Just on zoom. Actually, so we're about to. So run that, and then answer this quiz. What do each of these things do? If you want to learn about configuring different platforms, there you go. Yeah, you guys can read that one. So go ahead and execute that plot and then do that quiz. And when you're all done, go ahead and put the green sticky note up on your back of that plot.
Can you scroll up, please? So I can see the code again.
Thank you. Some clever way for you guys to track it. So, I mean, Carl's not a dummy. Is Carl here this year? Okay.
Yeah.
I just haven't caught up with him. So, all right. Okay, take care.
Recursion Analytics, and they're doing cell analysis and they pull out a bunch of features from a image of a cell sample, and they plot that on this 2D plot, and each data point represents an actual image. Well, they set it up using this hover tool, just like, right, you have one more line to this list that says image, and then a path, and then it pulls in from that data point number the correct image that goes with it. So their biologists can look at the data, they can hover over the dot, they can see the image come up and analyze it further. They can look real time. A whole bunch more. So, for a while.
What if you
want to
add a tool to the default set and you don't want to replace the default set?
Yeah, I think you just have to add all the defaults back in, and then that one too. I may be wrong in that.
I was wondering if there is a method on the plot that allows you to just add them, later, you know?
When you... Right, so...
Replace some of them, but not all of them, which is odd.
Yeah.
There's some core tools that don't go away when you use the list, and another one too.
So that's a great question, and what I would do get the answer to that is come over here to the Peter Bokeh channel and put that in and say, how do you do this?
Well, I was starting to Google when I ran out of time.
No, it's a great question. And I'm glad you asked because they are extremely active on their Gitter channel. They're very helpful. You can also, if it's more of a, that might even be another great question to throw up on Stack Overflow. They are a great community, and they will help you do whatever you need to do. So, lots of great resources. So that was the answer to number two. Click that help button, and that actually tells you how to get different interactive tools. And then, who figured out one additional tool? Well, I just went through one, so. In addition to these tools that you can configure, the figure method and the diamond method, they have several keyword arguments you can supply that provide ways to adjust this plot. So here, I'm adding a title, I'm adding an x-axis label, y-axis split height, the range I want to show. For the diamond, I'm going to change some of the colors, the alpha values, I'm going to add a legend, and there we go. Now it looks like this. And you'll notice I use line color and fill color, pretty self-explanatory. You can also just use color or just alpha instead of line alpha and fill alpha. Go ahead and do this next quiz. Look back up at what I just did there really quick and explore, figure out which settings, both args and keyword args, did I show for the figure, which did I show for the diamond, and then which took a single value, which did I use an array of values, because I said you could use either one, and go ahead and fill out that quiz. And when you're done, put the green sticky.
Are those palettes supposed to be like color coordinated? The ones that are like,
yeah. Like
they're all like they're just not a theme or something like that. Like
So if you want to go look at that, you can see all the palettes they have. Each of these different palettes have different uses. The category 10 that I'm using. is from the D3 palettes. It's also using Vega. Then it has all the color blue palettes. And then the other one I mentioned was this colorblind palette. So some of these are categorical, some of them are good for showing continuous gradient. Copy, pull that down, adapt, hack, make it so that You adjust, use a different color for each one, use a different alpha for each one. It can be either a single value, a series of values. You can use what I did or do something more interesting. Change the legend for each one. And then also, there, in addition to markers, where there's an individual data point for each individual marker for each data point, there's also the line option, which makes a line. And that looks great. So for one of those three, either Y1, Y2, or Y3, use line and kind of explore how that works. It's pretty much the same. You obviously don't have fill or fill out pump. But yeah, use lines and then two of those other markers to now make your own plot. And click here. So maybe like 5 or 10 minutes to do that. When you're all done, go to green up. If you have questions or issues, put your red up and I'll come around. Plot the same data twice. See what that is. X and a Y, and if I just want to make it work, I can just provide X more Y and Y. see that word. Then there's keyword arguments. Here is a bunch of keyword arguments. So Bokeh provides this great, or not Bokeh, sorry, where yes, you get the other one I can use with here inside the cell I can hit tab and then say, well, these are a couple guesses they have for me. The question mark pulls up the document.
So what would an example look like with buy three then? Like if you just came to buy like one of the ones you gave for the exercise as one and the line, how does that look?
You want to but I encourage you to try to play around and figure it out. Ask the guy next to you, he looks smart. see if you can figure it out. I'm happy to answer it. I kind of want it to be a struggle.
Thank you.
Thank you. Figure this should look just like what we had before. This looks a little bit different. I mentioned here I'm manually creating a data source, and you'll see that I'm giving it an empty list for both X and Y. You'll see why in just a sec. Now I'm going to create a, this circle one is from, I'm doing my fig.circle, which that's one of those markers we use. I'm passing it here. This source is a keyword argument where instead of plotting it, or instead of providing it with individual value or series for X and Y, you can tell it, I have this source, I want X to be the X value from the dictionary, Y to be Y, and it will plot that. I give it color just the same, an alpha value just the same. Here, this show command is going to update every time, or well, I'm going to use the handle on that to now, right here, in this while loop, it's using that handle to repeatedly push to the image, and these two commands, I'm randomly selecting a new value based on the mu x1, sigma x1, mu y1, sigma y1, and as I do that, I get this plot, which is adding new points as you go. Looks like it's, yeah, I'm going to, well, if you put a sleep in here, it's going to have an issue. So, but, yeah, so, pretty cool. I am doing a pseudo streaming data. I'm not like pulling real data from the web.
Yeah, my question is, what kind of processing overhead do you see in this? I mean, the problem that we ran into that you alluded to, and it's not the command plot wise, is if you have an ever increasing series of data, you're jamming these enormous arrays into it, and if you're arguing that something like a Raspberry Pi, it's just grind.
Yeah, so let me go like this. So up here at the top, you can see my process level, right? Let me just rerun this cell and show you how much it goes up. Going up a little bit.
Yeah, we've got 5-4 laptops, right?
Dual-core drives. But yeah, I mean, it is going up a bit. It might be because of the rate I'm pushing. You kind of have to play with it and see.
I think you'll probably cover this later on, but the answer to that will probably be an issue. If you're pushing a lot of data, you don't need to show every pixel. You only need to show the pixels for the resolution right here.
So,
we could average over a day, we could average or something, but is there a way to get it to update only the parts of the chart that have changed as opposed to completely updating the chart every time you jam a new array in it?
So depending on how you push and the way you call this, it will either re-render the whole plot or just update the parts you changed. And I'm 90% sure I did this right. And I'm only updating the data points there. This example came out of actually somebody at work wanted to set something up like this, and the way we originally went about it was regenerating the whole plot, clearing the plot, regenerating the plot again. So this, you'll notice there's like no flickering. It's not like deleting and re-rendering the plot. It's just adding more data points as it goes. Okay. So, kind of just playing around. Look at the one you generated. And can you get a feel for what mu x is, what mu y is, what sigma x, sigma y is? And you can zoom in on that. Kind of check it out. And then after you do, run this cell, and you can see how close you were to the actual values that you randomly generated. Once you do that, play a green sticky note.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, I mentioned here I'm manually generating new data. You can see it would be pretty simple to change this while loop to some kind of query or querying the internet, querying your data source, and pull that in instead of manually generating. And you can then similarly update this data source with new value. Yeah, so if this is in the list, it has to be the value here. But if this is a list, you could do something like you could replace the entire data source and then just truncate the end and minus 10. I have an example of that. And I found it as well.
And that might cause a full redraw, right? Like if you're changing your.
It still will only redraw the data. It'll just redraw.
So your whole kind of staging area is like, for example, if data was 20% earlier, it was
trying to figure out I saw this time.
This is a kind of where I got another example from. And here you see it's actually like string of data. There it's a sliding window there, it's redrawing the x-axis. Yeah, it's adjusting as if the data points to the program.
Can you show the constants?
So here, the new data x is assigned it to this x array, and then I just show the last and show the values. But it's very similar to the other. And I can put a link to this. I'll put a link to my
different using this if you're not inside Jupyter, if you're just trying to do it from a web page or a server app or something?
That's in the fourth part of this, we'll look at Vulkan Server, and it's very similar. The calls are going to be push notebook. There'll be a big server. The question was this notebook, it's very specific. Or the commands that we're using right now are very specific to the notebook. How does that generalize to using the script and running to a website? And it'll generalize really well, and I'll show that. Great. So you guys got to kind of play with your new and single values. Let's go through this exercise. I want you to copy in that code from above, add a second distribution. So now he's going to do a new X2, new Y2, some X2, some Y2, and add a second plot in that same window. Have it now every iteration of the Y1 is going to put 2 points on there, one for each of the two distributions.
That means
give it a different color. I originally had a sleep function in here, and Then I got annoyed because I wanted to see if they could get out, and I found that it didn't crash, so I went down. I think it's rendering. I'm not sure on the back end of what, like, where the weight is coming from, because it's maybe drawing.
One of the two is going to be one of the two. otherwise receiving 17 separate samples.
Yeah. If you leave it off, it's just like, oh, my gosh.
Curious about the way that the dots are drawn. The orange dots seem to always be on top of the blue dots, independent. Is this some sort of the index going on?
Yeah. So the question is, how are these drawn? Which is on top? If you look, the orange is plotted second. Yeah. The blue first, the orange second, and that can lead to problems in overlap. And the next section is gonna talk about ways you can look at that.
And that's based on the order that you call dot circle, right?
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
With data set two, you can call that dot circle second.
I, Yeah, it's a guy called, it's not based on the order that we call about stream.
There's a lot of, there's a lot of. Is this in the wild loop?
I think it's every duty that one.
Absolutely. I think it might be ordered on the stream.
On the stream. It's ordered by the stream.
Yeah, you can play with it too. Great, so let's go to the next section. What's the data share? So what happens when you have a lot of data? We're going to import Hollow Views. Hollow Views is the new higher level client API for Bokeh. We're going to tell Hollow Views we want it to output to Bokeh. You can also output to Matplotlib if you want to use Matplotlib. Maybe others, I'm not sure. So what happens when here I'm, this method is going to give me a set of Gaussian points centered at mu and sigma, and it's going to be, by default, it's going to be 10,000 points. You can adjust that. So let's look at five different Gaussian distributions centered at 2, 2, to minus 3, minus 2, minus 3, minus 2, 2, and 0, 0. And created all the points. And let's see what happens when I just plot it. Oh, wow, not really clear what's going on, right? So, well, maybe I should use alphabet, right? I have a lot of overlap. Let's go back and add an alphabet. Oh, okay. Yeah, maybe that's a bit better, right? Somebody up front here just mentioned that this killed his browser. So what happened here is Bokeh takes all those points, it passes all of them to the browser, and now the browser's storing all that in JSON and rendering all of those points. So
does it compress the JSON before it sends it, or does it?
I don't know the answer if it compresses it or not. I'm not sure.
Does that start making a difference, especially if you're not, once you've got a server, if you're going a long way? So.
Yeah.
Well, see what you just did about that. Did you hear that?
Everybody here. Right. So maybe this isn't the best way about this, right?
Maybe you need a new laptop.
I do need a new laptop.
I changed the fill off of the point 3 and the line off of the 0.
It's just hiding your data. Why does that help you?
It's hiding the lines. You still see the fill. And I can set it to the same. I don't think it looks as good for some reason. The lines tend to be like this.
Okay, I was just wondering why you would chose to do that.
So I sat here and I fiddled with these alpha values until I got something that looked sort of okay, right? Not very generalizable. So this isn't the best way about this, and that's what we're about to see. Question?
I'm seeing on those two like circles that look oddly defined. I'm wondering, is that sort of like pattern in the data where around this edge you will get more than three data points?
Right. So the question was, he's starting to see structure in the data, but what is that telling us? If we go back, I can see what sigma values I put in, and I can see where the mean values I put in. So there is structure in this data, but it's kind of hard to see right now. So let's dig into that further. And that's where data shader comes in. Data shader, the simplest interface is through Hollow Views. So how would you create a an element object and it's here? I use holidays, I single it, I want to create a function object, and I pass in all the data points, I give it a label, I told it about the different dimensions, so the first column in my points is the independent variables, the second column is the dependent variables, original, but this is the data. So now, what is this elements object? What if I just render that? Or what if I just show, the default output when I just go to look at it, it shows me a part. It looks about the same as that first part. If I so when I print it, I get the text descriptor, and it's this column use point element, these are the column values. But yeah, when I went to just output it directly, it gives you a plot. It's pretty logical about how it goes about this, but that didn't give us anything better, right? So now I'm going to use the data shade operation, and if I go back up here, I loaded this from HelloViews operation data shader. I pulled in data shade and dynamic. So right. So now what does that look like when you use data shade? Now it's not rendering every point. Now I get this nice visualization and zoom in on it. Yeah. Some people can see those different groups, right? So what's going on there? What's happening? So there's three components in this. There's bokeh, that's setting the x and y range for what I want to plot. Then data shader, it's going through this kind of process here where it looks at the data, it in the back end generates a scene. It'll look at each of the pixels and say how many points are in that pixel, and it does a color mapping to then assign a color based on the density of the points. And then it creates an image from that, which it then passes back to Bokeh, or well, to HoloViews, and HoloViews embeds that image in the Bokeh plot. And every time I zoom in on this, it reiterates that process, and it's using Numba in the back end. Go check out that project. To do this very quickly, and it regenerating those images.
Oh, so
yeah,
it's re-analyzing every time it's changed.
Right. If Bokeh will give it the new XY range, it reprocesses, remaps those. So, there's a lot of options you can adjust with this. In general, this is kind of the format you're going to use. And this is based on PyParsing. That was one of the dependencies you got when you set up the environment. You pass this ops, square brace the plot options, round brace the style options, square brace the norm options. But I don't expect you to walk away from here knowing how to do that.
We can look it up. But we can control the colors, for example.
Yeah, you can control the color map.
The shapes of the points, all that kind of stuff.
The points are always going to be points, you're essentially doing a scatter, but then aggregating them by pixel.
Okay.
Question right here.
Is there a standard refresh rate for the every time you the scatter gets generated,
of course, right. The question is, what's the standard refresh rate when you zoom in? I am not sure the answer to that question, but it's pretty fast. I've always been pretty impressed. I'm not sure.
Have you ever done it on a Raspberry Pi as opposed to a machine with two cores each?
No, I don't know. The question was, how would this handle on not as great of hardware? I'm not sure. I know that the backend for this is optimized using Numba, which writes code down to LDM. It's very well optimized, so it should work well. So one thing I wanted to point out is you'll notice that as I zoomed in, it looked the colors changed. That has to do with spreading. Here, I'm also calling the dime spread on the second plot. And if you look at how I generate these plots, it's very, in HoloViews, it's very simple to generate these plots. I do the add, and it added two sets of data to make these two functions, right? Or these two figures. And they're actually linked. Zoom in, they have a linked X, Y. So the one on the left is the original raw one that I had. The one on the right here, it's using dynamic spreading to spread out the pixels a little differently. And when you're zoomed out, they look essentially the same. As you zoom in, you start to see how that compares. You might have one, you might have the other. But yeah, that's there. And the key takeaway here is compared to where we started with this plot here, for the laptop breaker. this, you can really see what's going on in your data. You can see, it looks like, you look at that, you see five different distributions. There's one large one, and then these four that make a box. The spread is different on them. You get much better insight into what your data is. For this exercise, I want you to pull in that code from above, adjust, like change the number of points, go wild, go nuts, like make it big, don't do like billions of points, you might run out of RAM. use a lot more points than what I did here was 50,000 points across your laptop to generate a figure. You can do millions of points. As long as it'll fit in RAM, it'll render and it'll do that color mapping for the pixels and you'll be able to see it. And if you go look at the DataShare documentation, they have all these examples with the mirror taxicab data set, which the full data set is like 60 gigabytes, and they're visualizing that. And you can pull up that in. The demos are even like 1.5, but you can look at this scales very well.
So on the idea of scalability, say we happen to have 10 computer Raspberry Pis where it's spread the processing. Is this stuff smart enough or can be configured to spread out the processing?
So the question is, how do I distribute the processing for this backend across
multiple?
Can you have it? Yeah. To do that, I would look at the project Dask. Dask is a project for creating a distributed computation, and it'll break up things like what's going on here.
How do you spell it?
D-A-S-K. And it'll break it up across different, whether it's server or machines. It's similar to Spark.
Can it run on top of things like that?
Yeah. The specifics I'd have to know refresh, but yeah, it is a Python synonym or compatible or similar tool to and it's native Python, so it's not Python where you're writing books. So go ahead and adjust the position of the mu values, the sigma values, and play around and see what else you can do. And for this, you don't make that one. I'm going to go ahead and load my version here. I just added one more distribution, added some different sigma values. You can see where they are falling, right? We only have about 20 minutes. I don't think we're doing the link one. Let's go to the broken server. Okay. one. And then go to server icon. Okay. So in the beginning I talked about the different layers of Bokeh. You have the Python layer, which pushes out JSON to the JavaScript layer, which then pushes to the browser. The Bokeh server is a way to keep those in sync with each other, where you keep the Python in sync with the server, and they talk back and forth. You can update the Python, and it'll update the server. That link is cool. So you come back here, it's going to call that server, or if you want to fix my typo, change the .py to .py. So to kind of get right into this, I want you guys to take this code. You have hello server.py. And if you go to your materials, you have hello server. So come here, type in Bokeh serve-show. Hello server. And that will open a new tab in the browser, which this is the Bokeh server that we just created. If you say hi, I can just type it. I want to say hi to John. Hi John. So what's the code going into this? Jump back to the notebook here. There's essentially four parts to your Bokeh server. The given is your imports. Then you're going to create some widgets. We have the button widget, the output widget, the output widget.
This server will be the equivalent to your user's actual service.
Exactly. Yep. So we have a button, a say hi button. You have a text input right here, so you can put whatever you want. And then you have this output paragraph. Right? So then you're going to add a comment to the widget, which that's this step update, and it's going to change the output text property to be hello, and then that input value. And then when you push the button on click right here, you're defining that this button's on click property is going to call the update function. And then the third component of this is creating a layout, how you want it to be arranged, configured. And then the fourth is, this is going back to the question about push notebook when we were doing the streaming example. Here, curdoc is the current document, and I'm going to add this layout to the document, and it creates this server. Okay? So I want you guys to have this. I want you guys to add a select widget where you can have another box here that will select different readings. Maybe you want to use different languages, or maybe you want to say, hey, be more slang about it, right? Or add a select widget to this server app, open up the server.py, or hello server.py file, add in a new server widget, and then run it to see and test yourself. And I put a link here to the documentation. I added with this. When you finish, go ahead and put the green sticky up on your laptop.
Thank you.
So the question is, when you want to kill the server and reload it, do you have to go back to the command line and kill the previous server, and you can just up arrow to not?
Yeah, sure.
I
lasso tool, but here I'm going to select points, right? And you'll see these dots on the side update based on those points I selected.
Can you send them back to your Python server?
Yeah, they're going back to the Python, and it's regenerating this histogram on the side from the points that are selected. Right? So when this is done, I'll actually have it so that you can, this is a fitting function that I've set up where you can adjust the X min and Y min, and you can select points. Say, I want to figure out the mean and standard deviation of that group, and then I'll tune in the red bar and the blue bar, and I'll come in and fit on that and give you the values. Then you get it all working, but you see where this is going. It's pretty powerful, and this is what you get with it. So, while you're finishing up, we have 5 minutes left. I want to keep working on that. You come to the documentation, they have this gallery section, and you'll notice that I only just showed you. These are running Flowcase servers on their servers. So that one I just showed you is actually just happens from this. I adjusted the side points of it. There's a lot of other really cool servers in here. This one is great for data exploration. So here on the x-axis, this is a car data set. Let's say on the x-axis, I want to see acceleration. Y-axis, and we make color, and the size of each circle, and the horsepower. So there you see cars with the most horsepower. There, this acceleration value, lower miles per gallon, you can really kind of drill into your data using this and create some pretty exciting interactions.
Just kind of horsepower and acceleration, don't see that as strongly correlated.
I would have thought so too, that's why I picked up on this thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe you've seen the gap monitor. Yeah, there's this TED Talk where Gapminder data set, and you progress through time. Each of these circles represents a different country. I mentioned the hover. There, hovers over, you see where the country is. And as you progress through time, it changes. The size of each of the circles represents how large the population is. The y-axis is the life expectancy of it. The x-axis is the number of children for the woman. So you kind of see how it really lets you explore the data. And
it's the one that I think showed that the position that the amount of freedom women had in countries was directly correlated with the availability of washing machines.
So the question was, is this data set correspond to the amount of freedom women had in the washing machine? I do not know the answer to that question. So these ones at the top, these are different Flowcase server apps. Earlier somebody in the crowd as I was walking around asked if you could load up three-dimensional PDB structures of biomolecules and look at them. This is the 3D example I've seen. It doesn't have the same level of three-dimensional plotting as things like Pinemol, but it does have something. So get in and explore. If there's a feature that it doesn't have that you want, they're happy to take contributions. When I first looked at this, I was like, I'd like to use this, but I don't want to manually code in all the colors I want to use. So the color plot we've been using all day, I added that. So So they're happy to get you going, get you set up and figured out. Yeah, kind of browse through, look at all the different resources and finish up the brush. There's my information there. Feel free to create me if you have questions or thank you for your participation.